Hey CXI, thank you so much for having us. And first off, we're super excited to be here. We'll start with some introductions. There we go.
Hi everyone, I'm really happy to be there. I'm Arnaud Rouleau, I'm head of creative design at Deezer. I'm French, as you can hear, but I'm really, it's such an honor to open the dance floor. So just a few words about me. I've been working at Deezer for almost 10 years, starting as designers, and today I'm managing a team of 20 designers and motion designers. We are part of the internal studio. Thanks to this team, we are able to manage the brand communications at all levels, from the strategy to the final execution. Our scope is really broad. We are managing all the marketing campaigns, online, offline, the CRM part also, and also the content ecosystem, such as the covers creation. Above all, we are also the brand guardians, and we are the key contacts for the external agency. And last year, I had the pleasure to lead the rebranding topic with the support of Koto. And this is why we are here today.
Hey everyone, my name is Joe Ling, and I'm a creative director at Koto London. I oversee a team of brand designers, digital designers, and motion designers to deliver what we describe as creative excellence. And what we define that as is work that is visually compelling as it could possibly be while maintaining true strategic alignment. And today, we're here to talk about how we made the Deezer brand come alive.
So, you may know or may not know us. We are Deezer, I'm Deezer. We are the second independent music streaming service in the world with more than 10 million subscribers in 180 countries. We are 600 employees worldwide, mainly based in Paris. Just a bit of history. Deezer was created 15 years ago by Daniel Marelli. It was the initial developer. He did that in his kitchen. And his initial name was Blog Music. His initial idea was to provide unlimited access to music lovers through streaming technology. And then, a few years later, 2 years later, Deezer was born in a more legal way. This is our historical logo. This is the one that we kept the longest. And then, a few years later, we did a simple refresh, a simple evolution of this identity with the introduction of a new typeface, which is the Mabry font, and while keeping the same symbol, which is the equalizer. And then last year, we did an important step into our history with this rebranding. Actually, there is a clue in the page if you look in the corner.
So we work at the intersection of brand and digital, and basically Koto is 10 years old, and when we were first kind of born all that time ago, there were brilliant branding agencies doing great brand work, and there were excellent digital studios doing great digital work, but very few people were doing it under one roof. And Koto was born to fill that gap and build brands that are truly optimized to be inherently digital in the digital age in 2024. We're over 100 people globally, and we're based in London. I'm from the London studio. We have a studio in Berlin, Los Angeles, New York, and Sydney. And we truly believe that to build brands for a truly global audiences, that we ourselves as a branding agency should be truly global. And we have all sorts of kind of resource and knowledge pools from that true global coverage, from photographers to designers to strategists to art directors to everything that you could possibly need all under one roof. And we truly believe as an agency that that is our real power, that brand consistency built by consistent teams. We work with some of the world's biggest brands, but we also work with startups. We're really lucky to be able to be flexible enough to work with people from all levels of the branding scale. So we work for small startups, but also people like Nike, like Meta, and like Netflix. So it's a real kind of amazing ability we have to work at all different levels of scales of agencies and companies.
Thank you. That's a fair question. Why rebrand? Actually, at the beginning of last year, we were wondering how we could stand out in a saturated music market. It was time to rethink the brand. So we came up with a new proposition based on Deezer helps you to be yourself and find your place, to be and belong. We truly think that it was important to offer to the partners, to the fans, and to the artists a way to connect to the product and also to express themselves. At the same time, we looked at the product vision. We wanted to move from a digital streaming platform to an experience services provider. We truly think that music is a human experience that could be shared, felt, and lived. And also, finally, we also wanted to look at who we are, what is our culture, what is our DNA, what is our history. So based on that, we defined three personality traits. The first one is our boldness. We know that we are a challenger. We know that we have to take some risk. So this is our first personality trait. The second one is our freshness. We are music curators. We are test makers. We need to be in the know. And the last one is we wanted to have this little note of quirkiness. All those elements led us to a new positioning, which is Live the Music. So we had a new positioning, a new target, and a new personality. What about the new visual identity? Before starting, it was really important to assess the existing system. So did it fit to the new strategy? Did it fit to the new personality? We did a quantitative test to assess the existing system, and we discovered a lot of things. First, we discovered that 65% of people didn't recognize the logo if we hidden the name. Plus, a large number of them won't be affected by a change of this logo. So it was really a white pages for us, but we also wanted to look at that with our design perspective. So we did an internal audit, and we observed a lot of things. First, our system was really poor. We only have one typography, a really simple one and not really distinctive. We only have two waves. And just a logo at the heart of the system. It was a simple logo and an analogic logo in a digital world. And then the gradients and the colors, we had a different palette color between the brand and the product, and our only graphic principle was the gradient. So it wasn't enough to compose with, and we can see how much it was inconsistent at this time. We need to keep in mind that Deezer has been developed by developers passionate about music and not really about design. So those tech roots has fed the brand over the years. It was really time to move from a product that people use to a brand that people would love. A few words about the process. So we had the new positioning, the new target, the new personality, the new visual identity. We knew that we had to do something. Are we going to do an evolution or a revolution? Before starting, first things first, we wanted to create a huge brief, a really comprehensive brief, over almost 100 pages of details, because we really knew what we wanted to get. We knew that we wanted a rich system with a palette of options. So we wanted a strong logo, we wanted some typographic principles, some motion principles, some patterns. We wanted to have a clear color palette. We wanted to have some guidelines in terms of layout and composition. So we briefed 6 agencies across 4 different countries, including Koto.
So Deezer tasked us with, they invited us to pitch, and Koto don't pitch very often. It's now and again companies that approach us like Deezer where it's a particularly interesting opportunity we will pitch. One of the interesting things about the pitch is that we were given about a 2-week span, and we wanted to ensure that we got enough face time with Deezer to be able to understand what they really wanted beyond the brief, but also understand the personalities that were in the room that would be judging our work. So we split up the week into 2 presentations. The first presentation was going to be an initial workshop session where we would work with Deezer to kind of show some loose ideas made of initial reference and just see if any kind of wider ideas that we could potentially have would begin to resonate. See if there's anything in there that they were like, okay, this is exciting, I can really see some potential in this. The second week, we intended to take those ideas that did resonate and then build upon them into something that was more of an original piece of creative that they could really see the potential on and start to build further in their minds what the brand could be. So, in that first workshop, we thought we'd have this incredibly genius idea. It wasn't, where we started to build these routes out as potential playlists that they could hit play on and see how the future of the Deezer brand could unfurl. And we have 5 different routes. The first one was called For the Love of Music. The second one, Everyone is One of One. Third, Finding Favorite. Fourth, Change the Game. And 5, Mixing and Flexing. And these were all different ideas that we could start to circle about what the Deezer brand could be using existing reference, so see if there was anything could land at this initial stage that Deezer hopefully would see potential in. In a dream world, they would have chosen one of these routes or 2 of these routes and said, brilliant, we love the potential of this idea, let's go and make that, not just with reference, but with actual real creative. Unfortunately, they hated it all. And I don't blame them. We didn't hit the brief in the way we wanted to. We didn't actually really kind of show the systemized level of thinking that Deezer wanted to see. We kind of presented some loose ideas, but there was no visual thread that hung everything together. And in Arno's brief, in Deezer's brief, they made that incredibly clear that that's what they wanted to see. And unfortunately, we didn't do that. So we took it on the chin when it all went in the bin. This happens, as I'm sure you all know, to work in branding, you do have to be incredibly thick-skinned and you have to be able to think on your feet, because we knew that with a week to go, we had to come up with some new ideas that did show the level of systemized thinking that we wanted to display to prove to Deezer that we could work in the way they wanted us to do. So we then went the next week and we made 2 new routes. This first route was a community-focused brand. We kind of saw this idea, this hole in the market that Spotify, YouTube Music, the big music brands were never actually talking about listeners. They always put artists and bands on the platform to the top level of the brand, and they never ever elevate the fans, the people who engage with the music, to the front of the brand. And we thought there was some potential in this. We talk a lot about this idea of belonging, this new brand strategy, and that idea of fandom, the idea of passion to music. Why can't we put the people who love the music most, who love Deezer, at the very top level of the brand? And there were some interesting ideas within this where we started to kind of pair shapes that reflected different genres of music. For pop, it was poppy. For indie, it was slightly smoother. For rock, it was slightly more jagged. So there was the start of some systemized thinking. We wanted to make sure there was some humanity in it too through photography, putting people in the shapes of the genre of music they listened to, but also things like a word mark that was slightly hand-drawn, so we had that human presence. The second route was a route that built around a logo. It had one strong kind of idea at the moment, a logo as a symbol for belonging, a symbol for passion, a symbol for the love of music. And this is our second pitch route that you may or may not recognize, the start of something starting to happen here, where we presented this logo that had a real clear idea around it, that symbol of belonging, that symbol of the love of music, but also this idea of the fact that it could vibrate, it could change form to music, but also change form in the brand as well. So it didn't just have one purpose. It wasn't just a logo slapped on the corner of a page. It had a system that could actually be able to be taken away from it and do things like show people in the heart, show it as a pattern behind Drake on an album playlist, or even use it to start to show that people, certain people like someone there, Lil Sims, is loved by Tina, someone who listens to music on Deezer. So there was a sense of musicality built into every element of this. And this is the route that won us the pitch. This is the one that got us to actually make the final brand for Deezer and work with Arno and his team to actually bring it to life a lot more.
Why did Koto win? To be honest, they immediately captured what we wanted to get. They understood our intentions and our identity. It was really ambitious and we loved that. It was also the way they explained that, the way they rationalized the idea. It was really easy for us to understand their journey and the processes of working. So it was also easier for us to project ourselves and to federate the team with this idea. Also about the brand and the digital aspect, the digital and brand, It's not only a logo, it's about a whole system. How can we flex with this system to make sure we have the flexibility to communicate in marketing, but also within the product? So they had this expertise. And last but not least, the importance of the typography and the expertise that they have in terms of typography, it's really an important differentiating factor for us at Deezer. So we were immediately seduced by this approach. And plus, those people are really smart and nice. It was really a pleasure to spend all this time together.
It's quite important that you like the people you're going to be working with for the next 3 months. The next question was this idea of to evolve or actually start again with a brand and really start something completely new, to Evo or to Revo. And I think once we were chosen, once we were lucky enough to be chosen to become the selected partner to work on the brand, we headed back to Paris. We spent a lot of time in person. And these briefed us again. And we were given a three-track brief. The first one was an evolution. So taking what they had now, that kind of equalizer logo that we know they've had for a very long time, how could we build upon that to start to systemize it into a brand system that gave them the flexibility they needed and all of these other things they mentioned in their brief? So how can we hang a typeface off that? How could that system then apply to how we show typography? The next route was a revolution. And this revolution was the kind of going back to the drawing board. What would happen if the next stage of the Deezer brand was something completely new? And this is the pitch route that we just showed, that yellow heart. This was the start of that work. And the third one, which I'm going to be completely honest with you, was incredibly difficult, was the Joker route. And this route was the no brief brief. Deezer said to us, Koto, what would you do if you had no constraints? We weren't here. You were just making work as you wanted. What would that look like? And if I'm honest, after we'd already made 7 routes, I looked at them and was like, I have no idea. So that was a real challenge. We're going to talk you through each of these kind of, you know, pieces of work that we presented. This is about 2 weeks' work, I think, with my team in London to make sure that we kind of answered all of these different tracks. They all had their each own compelling idea and story. So this first one was the evolution. So this is where we're building off of what we have currently into a system. We, as Koto, liked the equalizer. We didn't think Deezer were using it potentially to the full capabilities they could. But we liked this idea of reactivity to music. An equalizer is a natural symbolism of how music is being played, how it feels, the sound it's making. And we saw real potential in this, to start to elevate that equalizer to be much more of a multi-state form, to be reflective of the types of music that people listen to. So when it's party, when people are partying, the music, the equalizer goes right the way up to the top and reflects that. But when someone's chilling, when someone's listening to Georgia Smith, a little bit more relaxed, it goes down. It reflects that style of music. And we saw real potential in this. So the brand is built off a grid system that is built by the equalizer, so using those forms. And that core idea is there, that reactivity to music, the reactivity to energy, how music makes people feel. But actually now we've built much more of a clear visual brand around that. So things like typography react to the positioning of the grid system. So even when we're not showing an equalizer, the type almost feels like it has that reactive state to reflect that idea. And when we're talking about other parts of the brand, when my clicker works, there we go, it still has that ability to be able to react to the different styles of music, whether it's EAG, whether it's party music, whether it's someone a bit more chill. That equalizer maintains that really kind of interesting idea of being reactive, taking on another life from what it had before and elevating it to be an actual, real kind of strong component of the brand. The next part was ensuring that we did have some elements. This is an evolution. We had to make sure that we were evolving elements from the current brand. Currently, as Arno mentioned before, Deezer used a color palette that was made up of a gradient. And we wanted to not completely lose the gradient because we knew it was a powerful asset for them. There was equity in it. How could we take the colors from that and not use them as a gradient, but use them as flat colors instead to build a slightly more consistent brand palette that hopefully would become slightly more ownable for them? A big part of this brief, as Arno mentioned, was typography and ensuring that we are using typography in compelling ways. Arno and his team really saw the potential in using type to brand and carry on a visual thread. So using a block-based style of typography really felt like it fit in with that blocks that make up the equalizer to continue that visual thread. We started working at this point with our tight partner, Luke Prowse, who runs NAN, who are a Berlin-based tight foundry. We involved him early on because we knew there was real potential in doing some really compelling custom typography work with these, with Arno and his team. And we wanted to start exploring really early on what that could be. This really kind of slightly odd display typeface that builds the blocks into that system, you know, really kind of feels very compelling, but also has that actual DNA of the equalizer built into it. Or perhaps it can actually just be based upon the counters of the typography. What would it feel like if the standard condensed typeface had a blocky nature to it, but wasn't actually blocky, and we just used those in the counters of the typography? How could we be slightly more subtle with it? And we wanted to make sure that we were kind of exploring all the potential options of what we could be. So you can see in that dollar sign where it says scar, you can really see how those block-based forms make up those counters and still communicate that visual thread, but in a way that is slightly more subtle than the last one. The next route we showed was the Joker route. And as I said, this was the one that was quite difficult to come up with a new idea. But we had a go. We always are set to challenge. And this one, the story of this route was all about how it feels when you listen to music. The effect it has on your day, that when you press play on Deezer, how you could be sat on the bus, you could be laying on the beach. When you hit play, that music kind of takes over your world and transports you to somewhere else. And we started using things like illustration and collage to be able to start to kind of show that effect the music can have on your day. There we go. And so when someone's listening to Miley Cyrus Flowers, you know, things like flowers can start to pop up. We use really interesting illustration. When someone sat at home chilling on the sofa, reading a book, they hit play and start listening to Dua Lipa, and suddenly that kind of atmosphere, that feeling is completely transformed. It's worth the wait, guys. Every time, it's worth the wait. And then when you start to get that feeling that the music creates, it transforms where you are, it transforms your mood, and transforms how you feel. I'm going to move to this side of the stage now. And that brand now started to really kind of come to life in different contexts, from out of home to other moments within the brand where we wanted to kind of show humanity. We still love the idea of community at the top level of the brand, but showing emotion through music, so whether it be someone crying and listening to music, that feeling of energy, that boost it gets, this is what happens when you press play on Deezer. This world of color, this world of imagination that kind of come to life, we found really compelling. I think my favorite part of this route was the logo, the idea of a D and a play button. D for Deezer, a play button. Obviously, one of the most important elements of the Deezer product is that ability to press play and have something branded. And we thought there was a real kind of, you know, opportunity to brand a play button that no one else is really doing in the sector. And so we liked this idea of a play button that had this interesting shape at the middle that almost feels like it could be representative of a catalyst. What happens? That explosion of color of life of what happens when you hit play. So we thought there was real potential in this of the story. The next route was the revolution, but we'll come back to that in a second. So after this, we put two routes into testing. Deezer's marketing team took the routes into testing, started talking to users about that, the different ways they felt. Did they feel like they've had more of a relationship with this new brand? Do they feel like it was more compelling than the old brand? And there was, luckily enough, one clear winner, which was our revolution, which was the route, the build on our pitch route. So, where did we end up? Let's start with our logo. So the logo had that kind of story right the way from the pitch route that we found really, really compelling, that had that sense of belonging, that passion for music, that represented by a heart, but also that equalizer, that sense of musicality built in. And we quite liked the fact that that sense of musicality felt like it was slightly evolutionary from the current brand, but now used in a slightly different way, where actually we represent a sense of music through movement in a logo. So those beat forms, those oblong shapes that make up the logo, become the core of the brand system, which we'll talk about in a minute. But they intentionally fluctuate, so they have that feeling of when you look at an equalizer, you see the different levels of music, they all become able to move independently to create a core feeling that is brought to life by that story of the passion and love of music represented by that heart. And I think when we kind of, you know, were pitching early on, we were kicking around this idea, we had no idea that there was work going on separately that had this core idea of where music comes alive. And I think when we kind of put the two and two together of where music comes alive and this sense of a heart that represents music, but beats like a human heart to show that you're alive the way you feel when you listen to music, it felt like a bit of a match made in heaven. My favorite thing about this brand is that I've never made a brand that dances. I've never made a logo that can headbang, that can sway, that has all these other types of movement. And when we come up with this idea, I remember talking to our motion director, Santi, about it. He looked like he wanted to cry when we said, let's make the logo headbang, but he made it work because he's a genius. And this is a really nice way that we start to build in that inherent sense of musicality into this logo. If the logo can dance, surely that is the best shortcut for a music brand that we could possibly build into something. But of course, it has to react to music as well. And this kind of different sense of movement, those kind of, you know, movement up and down of those oblong shapes, the beats that make up the brand, show just how they can react to different genres of music. Whether it's slightly more intense, slightly more chilled, that kind of idea of reactivity is kind of turned up somehow in every single route that we've built. And we think that is a really lovely story to be able to tell. And this is the kind of start of that idea of a logo that wasn't just a logo, it formed a brand system, formed a visual thread that would be applied to every single part of the brand, which answered the brief that Arno and his Deezer team set. But this wasn't the only logo we drew. To get that real potential, that real sense of musicality, that real sense of something that we could potentially build a brand system across, we had to try a whole load of other things. And when I look back, some of these aren't our finest work, but I think it's important to try everything you possibly can to make sure we can extract the value we need to extract the value from that logo to make sure it does what we need to do. Whether it's optimized to work at small scales, whether it has that, you know, potential to build a visual system of, whether it actually talks to the love and passion and the sense of belonging that comes from music, but also that sense of feeling like music itself. So a little insight here of the different ways it went from trying more kind of human-drawn forms to slightly more actual, like, kind of reflections of what music looks like when it's being played, slightly more graphic, slightly flatter. We tried a lot of things, but we knew we'd really hit the kind of jackpot when we really started to see those two logos in the bottom there really start to move to music. And we knew we'd really hit the jackpot when someone got it tattooed on them. And I think this is the really interesting thing to me about when a logo that is symbolic of a wider strategic story, that if we want to make a logo that is representative of a love of music, it almost becomes separate to Deezer, which is amazing because people can own that sense of I love music, I love musicality as a symbol, and it takes on its whole life of its own as a symbol for belonging, exactly like Deezer want, but fans can own it in their own ways. And I think, like, you know, when we saw this photo, it was a real moment of being like, yeah, people like it, we've done it. It was very exciting. The next part is the brand system, and this is probably the most important part of the brief. And I think throughout the pitch, throughout all of the process of working with Deezer, system, the visual thread was the thing that kept coming up, and we really knew we had to make something that was inherently incredibly flexible, but still carried the momentum and shapes and forms that make up the logo, so that it had that clear kind of, you know, aesthetic which traveled all the way throughout the brand. And so we started to build these really big, bold patterns out of the beats that make up the logo, those oblong shapes. And what we love about this is that there's two kind of senses, there's two kind of sides of the story. The first side of the story is that fundamentally, they feel like they're reacting to music. They feel like music, they feel like an equalizer. But we also love the fact they feel like heart rates, they feel like humanity, they feel like how you feel when you're at a gig and all your hairs stand up on end as that artist starts playing. Your heartbeat increases, or when you slow down at the end of the day and you put something a bit more chill on, your heartbeat slows down. So that play between humanity, belonging, a love of music was always there throughout the whole brand system. And these kind of shapes are all designed to work both in motion and in still. So they have that pulsing ability like a heart, but also in still, they're still reflective of different genres of music, different styles of music, but they also have that kind of inherent sense of movement built into them even when they're not moving, which we always saw as a real kind of interesting asset for the Deezer brand. They work best in motion when you have that ability to extrude, to change the shape, to make them flutter, to make them bounce. We always saw so much potential in what they could be, and whether they're more simply applied, if there's just one beat that kind of moves along as a transition, if there's multiple beats that flutter, we were always really excited about this feeling that we could create when we had that ability to use them in motion in all kinds of different ways. And this is a bit of insight into the brand system where you start to see how those elements start to come together. That really clear shape where you connect the logo to those kind of fluctuating beat forms, but also the fact how the motion animates as well. Motion is such a big part of this brand. If we're talking about that love of music, the beats, they should always have that sense of motion built in. So being able to build that motion into that wipe as it comes across the screen, we think is an awesome way that we could start to actually tell that story of the logo through every other part of the brand. These shades make up genres of music. They make up stories about how people go about their day. Heavy metal on the commute, ambient or the office, and then techno, techno, techno. And the brand reacts to that. And that ability to be able to flex between different styles and genres of music, we thought was a really nice moment that could be used in product. But again, it's another way that that visual thread from the logo starts to do something else. So we start to build equity into so many parts of our brand that aren't just the logo. The next really big part of this job was the typeface. And we knew that the Apple Musics, YouTube, Spotify had their own distinct custom typefaces. But I said they were distinct then. They were not. They're not distinct. They're not particularly interesting. They double down on functionality. To be honest, they're a little bit boring. I'm sorry if there's anyone from any of those three companies here today. But they're functional for a reason. They have massive amounts of application. Of course, I completely understand that. But we knew straight away there was potentially a way that we could double down on something really compelling for Deezer that could carry on that visual thread from the logo, but also really kind of, you know, enable Deezer to have something that enabled them to carry on their brand in places where the logo perhaps wasn't quite as prominent, but that spirit of the logo, the feeling of musicality, those shapes that make up the logo could be in that typeface. So if someone covered up the logo, it's still distinct as Deezer because of that really compelling typography. And so we built this typeface that was variable. I'll come back to why in a little bit on that, but it had that geometry of the logo, those beat forms that appear everywhere. And if you look at those E's, if you look at the counter in the D, they all have those forms built in. And what we hope eventually is that Deezer will be able to use this in the same way Nike do with their own typeface, where they have that level of ownability, that level of equity, where we don't even have to have a huge logo to say we're Deezer. Because this typeface has that inherent connection to the wider brand and also feels so differentiated against competitors. We really think this is going to be an amazing tool for them moving forward. As I said, this typeface is variable, and this starts to give a small insight as to why. When we're building systems for Deezer, they make thousands of playlists every single year that all have different names, from the Black Eyed Peas to Ne-Yo, to King Krul, all kinds of different type lamps. And so when we had to build something that could be flexible enough, all these different systems, we wanted to make sure that the typography could be as flexible as the systems were and the names were. So when it had to be really big and bold for a three-letter name, it had that capability of doing so. But when you had a much longer name like the Black Eyed Peas, it does become a lot more condensed and a lot smaller. So you had that flexibility inherently built in to make sure that system could work at every stage. And this is where you can start to see how that logo starts to connect to those forms to make that kind of coherent brand vision while the logo dances away on top of the type. Our colors, a really big part of this was finding a really distinct color palette for Deezer. Again, YouTube Music, red. Apple Music has that red icon, generally a black and white brand. Spotify has a lead green that we knew we couldn't go into any of these territories. When we were looking at color, there was no way we could ever beat Spotify on Spotify green, YouTube were red. So what could we seize upon to find that distinct color for Deezer? So first of all, we always do our due diligence at Kota. We always make sure we're looking and analyzing what the wider sector is doing, trying to find those holes in the color palette and the color wheel where brands currently weren't capitalizing upon. And these, the big ones that had potential for us, were yellow and purple. As you saw in the pitch route, this is where that yellow came from, that clear space in the color wheel. We actually just stopped moving forward with yellow just because, particularly in the product experience, we had some real tricky kind of issues with accessibility. And we decided to see a lot more value in purple, not just because we like the color, but also because we kind of had a bit of a story around it. Purple is a mix of red and blue. Red, a color that signifies energy, passion. Blue, a color that signifies life. When they come together, that human element of the brand, that sense of passion for music, is built into purple because of the combination of those two colors. But we also love that it had musicality built in as an idea. And when we sold this in, we put a picture of Prince playing Purple Rain over the top, and it just, for some reason, felt really right. Not just because of that kind of, you know, ability to create a whole clear space in the color wheel and know we're distinct at that level, but because of the emotional reasoning as well. We knew we couldn't have a color palette that was a one color brand for Deezer. There was no way with the amount of different assets they need to make, the different things that where the brand needs to be applied, they could ever just be a purple brand. So we also accompanied it with an orange, a turquoise, and a yellow as well that enabled them a little bit of flexibility. We're not using them too much at the moment because we need to build equity into this before people understand we're a purple brand before we start using other colors. But it's just showing that ability further down the line, we have that level of flexibility where required. But as I said, flexibility, the biggest thing for Deezer. When they're making thousands of playlists a year, we had to find a way they could essentially use any color they wanted. So this is the wider palette where we start to unite with those kind of, you know, rainbow-like tones through hue and saturation, show there is an inherent connection back to Deezer Purple just because they feel relatively comparable in how they appear. But we always knew flexibility would be the real kind of main thing for Deezer. Deezer are a digital project, they're a product, they're a digital streaming platform. We knew whatever we made had to be able to work in the UI and also maybe even bring the UI to life. At Koto, we speak a lot about how we're constantly trying to close the gap between marketing and product. The closer these two things can become, the more aligned and more consistent a brand will be because people see how connected they are. You bring all those synergy between product and marketing, you start to build that real level of consistency. So we wanted to find ways that we could use the brand and start to use that UI in our brand communications to elevate that story that this is a digital streaming product. We are inherently talking to specific music, specific tracks, sorry, and actually that we are a digital platform. So being able to use the beats, those forms that we have in our logo, to kind of stick onto the edge of a sound player, immediately brands it. But again, reactivity is a really important thing because they have that reactive state, that ability to react to the different styles of music. It gives it that sense of kind of dynamism as well. So this is an amazing asset for Deezer to be able to use wherever they show up to communicate that fundamentally, wherever we show, we are a digital streaming platform and we are not Spotify. One really big thing as well is things like icons. We have this saying at Koto, the biggest element of a brand, an out-of-home campaign that costs millions of pounds should have a visual connection back to the smallest part of the brand, an icon. So be able to use those kind of beat forms, those shapes that make up the logo, down in the icons to create that visual thread between the two things was something that we saw value in really early on. And being able to kind of design that distinct icon palette, which had that real same feeling as the rest of the brand, is a really great way to build that connection between brand, marketing, and product. The next system we had to build for Deezer was editorial. And this is where, this is the editorial, is those playlist covers, those thousands of different genres of music, of specific artists, flashback party, disco, all of those different types of playlists that Deezer have to make. We wanted to make sure that they had a level of kind of flexibility, but also consistency throughout all of this. The first thing we built was this kind of extractions of the shapes that make up the logo. So those beat forms that could react to different styles of music, different genres. And you can start to see on the right there how they start to make up part of a grid system that enables us to place typography, imagery, and these patterns over to keep flexibility, but also have a sense of consistency as well. This is how the full set comes together. So you see that wider color palette, that ability to use different kind of, you know, imagery, whether it be cut out, whether it be full bleed, whether we lean into actual graphic patterns in the background, perhaps they start to hold typography. Perhaps our typography can be condensed. Perhaps it needs to be wider. There is that real kind of level of flexibility, but there is also consistency. And that was that really important piece about that systemization. What keeps consistent, but what enables flexibility was a real challenge for this. And so, to conclude, or move towards conclusion, we've got a little video which will show you how all of these elements come together and a bit about the story of how we got there. How was it received?
Yeah, that's a good question. Thank you, just so great to get back to that again. So it's probably too early to assess the impact of this rebranding on our business, but we already have some great insights. The first one about the adoption. We know how much adoption is key internally, but also with, through our customers. Have we seen internally with the tattoo picture, the job is done. It's really important, and also through our customers, we have great feedback about that. They really love this new identity, and not just the logo. They would like to see more of this system and more of the patterns of the motion principle and the illustration. So that's really great. We also did the first campaign where we basically the objective of this first campaign was really to set up the foundation of this new identity by introducing the new symbol, the new color, and also the new typeface. We have the best historical attribution to Deezer with this campaign, so it's really great. And last but not least, we also have as designer a better flexibility every day. We have all the richness of this system and we can play with. If we want to communicate about summer, we can play with the illustration. If we want to talk about diversity, we can use the art direction principles. So we have really a large palette of possibilities. So I'm not going to deep dive into these figures, but they speak for themselves. We hugely increase the brand image for our customers, and they wanted this emotional part, and we see the result through the engagement of our customers. So yeah, it's a success. Just a few takeaways to sum up this huge journey. But collaboration is key, yes, it's key. We had the expertise in intern, but we also have the knowledge of our complex ecosystem. But Koto brought to the table their expertise and the objectivity to make this challenge a success. So yeah, this collaboration was really key. Do you want to add something, Joe, on that?
No, it's just that they, Deezer couldn't keep us out of Paris. We kept showing up. They couldn't get rid of us. The second one, chemistry and pitches. We really believe at Koto that when we do pitch, the best thing we can do, the most successful way of potentially building a relationship in that pitch phase is ensuring we spend time together, understanding what Deezer want beyond the brief, having conversations, meeting in person so you understand body language, ensuring that we can really have more casual conversations about what we need to do that don't feel uptight, that don't feel uncomfortable, that can be truly honest. When Deezer told us they didn't like any of the initial work we presented in the workshop, we wanted to prove to them that didn't matter. We were willing to keep building and keep moving and hopefully build something they did truly love. And we only would have been able to have a relationship as good as ours and Deezer's is now because of that kind of chemistry we built in that early stage. So we really believe that is the superpower that has made this work so successful, is having that level of chemistry and ability to be completely honest with each other. Also, I know this is potentially controversial, but we really believe in person is invaluable. Spending time together, understanding each other, meeting as many people as we possibly could from Deezer so that we could understand the issues they were having with the brand themselves, whether it be someone in B2B sales, whether it be someone in digital, whether it be someone in the marketing team. Having the ability to sit down, talk to them, understand their woes, understand their current problems with the other brand is something that would drive adoption, because when they see the personal issue they're having fixed in the brand, they will then adopt that brand to begin to use it. So we truly believe those conversations, that ability to communicate and understand each other is really, really invaluable, particularly when it's in person.
Go big or go home. We know how much it can be difficult to take this kind of decision. It's a huge change for the company. But we also know that daring is always reward. And we also know as designers and for our customers that the consensus can be really boring. So you can take risk. It's really important. You just need to test first and digest the result, and then you can move forward.
Oh, And the last one, clear ideas in hearts and minds. And that ability we had from the start to be able to talk about why we thought a love heart, something that isn't traditionally associated with music, with the right creative treatment could be representative of music. So it's incredibly easy for anyone to understand and say, we're building a brand that is around that core story of a love of music directed by this core symbol and a logo that was a heart, passion, love, that had that sense of musicality built into it by movement. That clear idea that's represented by the logo, which is then duplicated throughout the brand, is what enabled people at Deezer to understand the direction and understand and have that kind of casual conversations about what it could be. It wasn't lofty. It wasn't hard to understand. It was a simple concept which enabled people to be able to discuss it and understand it really clearly. And I think that is the most important part of any brand that we create, that ability for people to understand, resonate, and explain it to each other and all feel like they have a kind of core kind of, you know, attachment to that story, which is easily digestible for anyone who comes to touch it. Thank you so much, guys. That's our talk.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Jeff. Right.